Happy Sunday, everyone!
Happy Sunday!
And as we always do each Sunday, if we can start with a word of prayer before we worship. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for yet another week, another beautiful Sunday that we get to gather, not physically, we get to gather virtually, Lord, to worship you because quarantine or not, coronavirus or not, Lord, you are still great and you are still good and you are a faithful Father. So may we not forget the work of the cross and just the sacrifice and the love that you have poured out over us, Lord, as your children. So we thank you, Lord, as we sing praises to you. May our hearts be full of gladness. May our hearts be full of joy and refreshing from you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Next song is called God Is For Us. It's a new song by City of Light.
Found it.
fortress. Raise your voice now. No love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? Amen. And God, as we go into your word, as we go into your message, speak to us, Lord. Speak powerfully through the message, and help us to remember the gospel, God, throughout this week, Lord, and let us sing your praises, Lord, every day, Lord. So we thank you, and it's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Home Church's Sunday service. We are glad to have you here. For the children watching this at home, you may be dismissed if your parents tell you. And for the rest of us, let's take the next few minutes to greet one another and welcome each other. Take the next few minutes to text or message or send emojis to one another. You can wave hi or do a hug emoji. And if you're new here, don't be shy and say hi as well. We'd love to welcome you.
I was breathing, but not alive. And all my failures, I tried.
Good afternoon. Our first announcement today is there is an All Shepherds meeting today at 4 p.m. On Zoom. So both villages will be meeting today after the service. And so if we can be in prayer for our leaders that they would have an awesome time of fellowship and encouragement as they meet today. And our next announcement is our monthly ask meeting is coming up in a couple Sundays, June 7th, the first Sunday of the month. And this is for anyone who is not a Christian, or if you're not sure if you're a Christian, this is a meeting between you and Pastor Mitchell where you're able to ask any questions and learn more about what it means to be a Christian. And so if you are interested, the last day to sign up is June 5th. And you can sign up through our website, thehomechurchroland.com, under Bible study classes and ask meeting. And last Sunday, Pastor Mitchell announced that we have three summer classes being offered. And so the first one is Transformation Bible Study. And this is a 10-week course being taught by Pastor Mitchell. And so if you have successfully completed Foundation Bible Study, this is kind of the next course. So please prayerfully consider about signing up for this. They're going to meet every Tuesday night from 7 to 9 p.m. starting June 16th. And the next class is Apologetics Overview, being taught by Lucas Cow. This is an 8-week course, and this is for church members and non-believers. And they're going to meet on Thursday nights at 8 p.m. starting June 18th. And so you could read more about what this class is going to cover on our website. And the last class is Life Together. It's actually a course for THC women being taught by Hannah Kim, and it is a 12-week course. And so this is for any THC woman who has successfully completed Foundation Bible Study class. And all of these classes have class capacities, and it's on a first come, first serve basis. And so if you are sure about taking it, go ahead and go onto our website right now and sign up. All classes have a deadline of June 8th, and all classes are $10. If you go onto our website under the Bible Study Classes tab, there is actually a separate website page for each of these where you can read more about the course and what it's going to entail and the commitment level as well. And so, yeah, go ahead and read more about that on our website. And our last announcement is the Homecast. The Homecast is our newly launched podcast. It's actually been about a month now. We just released episode 4 this past Wednesday with Chris and Ad and I talking about their missionary adventures. And so there is going to be a new episode every Wednesday, so be on the lookout for that. The only way to listen to our podcast is by downloading our church app. So if you haven't already, please go ahead and go on to the Google Play Store or the Apple App Store and download the Home Church church app. And then you have access to our podcast along with our service and testimonies. And so if you have any questions or trouble accessing, please let me know. And now we're going to move into a time of Chelsea sharing her testimony with us. So thank you. Bye.
Hi THC, happy Sunday. Hope everyone is good and safe. I'm Chelsea Price, and I'm from the Ethiopia Family Church with Chris and Adonai. I am new to THC, though I've made some friendships. I still have so many I haven't got to know. A little bit about me is I'm 28, and before the quarantine I was coaching volleyball. I may not seem athletic, but volleyball is my life. I love my dogs. I have a Pitski, which is Pitbull Husky, a Pitbull, and a Chiweenie, which is a Chihuahua and a wiener dog. I have an older sister who is nothing like me, and parents that don't look alike, but both share the same soul. I am black and mixed. I'm pretty sure I'm the first African American member of THC. And I'll represent proudly. I have been a Christian since I was very young. A great man and pastor named Chuck Smith said, to believe in Jesus was like breathing. I don't remember a time when he wasn't there, and that was very much my life. From a young age, I had conviction and a need to repent to God for his forgiveness. And then God told me I did not need to ask Jesus to save me from damnation every time I sinned against him. He had died on the cross one time, and that he had already forgiven my sins. I had given my life to the Lord. When I got a little older, about 9, I could fully grasp God's grace when I got teased by the young girl who lived on my street. Here we have a young girl like me and a sinner like me. Now when I sin, Jesus shows his grace, and if I am to be like him, I too can show grace. I turned around and shared the gospel with her and invited her to church. I was very sensitive to the Lord's voice and will in my life, but all I wanted to do was live for him and to share it to everyone I know. Both of my parents are Christians and encourage love for God. When our family hit hardships, that's when my faith would grow stronger. I was fortunate to have parents to sacrifice to keep me and my older sister in Christian schools. So that's how I learned so much about the Bible and how to apply it to my life. It made me unpopular a lot, but I never got in trouble. In fact, friends would say they were hanging out with me so their parents would let them go out. When the parents would see me, they would say, hey, you're the good friend. My first public school I went to was community college, and right away I was the weird one. I was definitely out of my element. So I started going to this college group at my church, which is also my high school. This ministry was called Impact Generation. Pastor Mitch was the pastor of the ministry at that time. He had this mentality that all of us here are young, not married, or have families yet, so why not use this time to go all out for the Lord's kingdom? And even now, he still holds helping VIPs as our ultimate priority in ministry. Impact Generation will go above and beyond for those who needed help. Mitch and Lena helped me to come clean and get help with my eating disorder when all the leaders would support and pray for me. They all saw growth in me and gave me a Bible, and they all signed it, even little Belle too. No pun intended, but they left an impact on lots of lives. After some time, this guy from high school was coming around and we started hanging out a lot. We started a friendship that jumped to love. After much hesitation, lots of prayer, we became official. Our friends were so supportive. We were so happy, but we faced issues that no one that young should ever have to go through. And here's where I start my story. My boyfriend was telling me about this anxiety he was experiencing. I started to see something wasn't okay. My boyfriend had stopped sleeping. He would wander off, get lost, write his thoughts on walls, mirrors, or any piece of paper he could find. This grew into mania. For those of you who don't know what mania is, in simple terms, the brain is so tired it heats up and your body has this energy, almost like superpowers. And they can go and go and go and never get tired, and then they crash, go to sleep, and it's the best night's sleep. But when he woke up, he had lost functioning. December 2012, I got the call that my boyfriend was in the psychiatric hospital. He was released a few days later, but even more shocking news. His family wouldn't let me see him or talk to him. This went on for 2 months. No one could comfort me because no one could relate to me. I started to pray. I wasn't sleeping or eating, making myself sick, but I could still pray, so I did. My boyfriend was diagnosed with severe mental and mood illnesses. But that was not who he was. He was kind. A man of prayer who feared God, never without his Bible, always ready to share the gospel. He taught me to always prepare your faith now because you never know what storm will come. The next storm was an attack on my health. I was extremely ill and getting worse. I was diagnosed with lupus in 2013. Lupus is a severe autoimmune disease and very painful to live with. But with the right treatment, you can reduce the pain symptoms and viruses from reoccurring. While we were together, he took care of me anytime I was sick or in the hospital, drove me to appointments, helped with meds, and in scary times when I couldn't even get up, he cared for me. We both believed in God's power and love in our lives. And we use our story to help others in hard times. Our relationship had become an engagement after 2 years. But our families thought we were out of our minds to believe two people like us with such hard disabilities could ever make it work together. And neither of our parents supported the relationship. Now my fiance was in the hospital again, and then again. I had finally canceled the wedding. Our family was making it difficult for me to be there for him the way he wanted me to be. His mother eventually said to me her son and I were dying, and I had finally surrendered. I fought as much as I could. He was and still is very much the love of my life. He was my partner. A year after the breakup, I started to get angry. Then that anger turned to hate. I hated his family for taking my peace away. I had hardened my heart and got into a dark place. I had fallen into depression and even deeper into sin. Ashamed knowing God being so holy, it would contradict who he is to watch what I was doing to myself. Doctors put me on antipsychotics and other depressants from my panic attacks. For over a year of faking to be happy and living my sinful lifestyle, did I finally hit rock bottom. I was in my room, at home, in bed, with two full bottles of sedatives, and I overdosed. No one knew to check on me, but hours later I had woken up. There is no way a human should survive that. I had started talking to a professional therapist, but I would hesitate to share. 2 weeks of me not talking in therapy, I went for a drive. I drove so far, I realized there's nowhere I can run to get this relief. I knew what I had to do. I needed to deal with my hatred. I needed to forgive myself, but I also needed to forgive my ex's parents. In prayer and boldness, I found his mother's number, called and drove to their house to see her face to face. She apologized first for everything. I couldn't believe it. And with a heavy heart, I too apologized for the hatred I had towards her. And we felt his peace on us. She is someone I now love with all my heart and will cherish. My ex and I did reunite last year and had sweet memories. Then at the end of the year, we said our goodbyes. I am no longer in a relationship, but I pray for him and his family. He needed prayer in his life during our relationship, and I needed to be shown how to love like Christ loves. God used the two of us and will use his followers in many ways, in mighty ways too, to show his greatness and his love. For years, I had felt God telling me to come to church here. I'd find reasons to stay away until sooner or later, God said, come home, aka church. Early last year, I came home from a trip overseas. My heart was heavy with grief after my return, imprinted a similar experience I had on mission trips in the past. I still have no idea what it means for the future, but I wanted to be part of a culture that would teach me Christ's mission through their eyes. As soon as I got to THC, I was welcomed by Papa Mitch Sr. and just burst into tears. I was so broken, just totally beat down by all that I had put up myself through. I persisted and kept coming to this church. I have a friendly face from the past here, Ariella, who is a shepherd and serves in ministry here. She also went to Impact Generation all those years ago. So one Sunday after church, Ariella and I drove together in my car to get food. Then I felt the courage to just be vulnerable about my life. She had no judgment, but actually understood me and loved me. I believe this helped me later on when I joined a family church. It's weird at first, I'm not going to lie, but the more you go, the more natural it becomes to just share your brokenness and receive prayer and support without asking. I decided to become a member because my spirit was so full coming here after being empty for so long. My spirit needed a Christ-centered community, and that happened here. He gave me grace. I didn't want to run away this time. Today, I hope and pray you can trust that God wants you when you're lost and broken. Please, during this time, keep fighting for whatever reason you're alive. You have a lot of fight left in you. And let God be Lord of your life. I got a tattoo after learning what the suicide survivor symbol was, the semicolon, and I got it right here. It means to have the option to end, but decide to keep going anyway. Romans 8:18. Now remember that the current suffering is nothing to be compared to the future glory, and that is Jesus. This verse has become so real throughout my whole life. I can actually touch it. Absolutely everything I went through was not for nothing. He had a plan the whole time. Because now I took back Now I look back and I know I was never fighting alone. We weren't the fighters. Jesus was fighting the whole time. He kept us safe and comforted. It takes a lot of trust on our part, and that's why he has promises in the Bible. Promises that he can save you from your circumstances, whatever it may be. Jesus loves you. It gets said a lot, but it's true. And I pray it speaks differently for you today. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Chelsea, for that testimony that really encouraged our church. And for all of us that are watching, let's go ahead and right now, might seem weird to you, but just extend your hand towards the screen as we lift up our sister Chelsea to the Lord. So let's pray for her as a church. Father, we lift up our sister Chelsea to you. We thank you for bringing her to our church family. And we thank you that though she's been through valleys of suffering, you have filled those valleys with hope and strength and the reminder that our ultimate satisfaction comes from you and comes in the next life. We thank you for her recent commitment to become a covenant member of our church. We thank you for working in her that desire to no longer run away from community, but to really settle down and lay her roots down here at the home church. God, I pray that you would use her in our congregation. May her strengths and gifts and passions work their way into the life of this church. And may her family church and our church as a whole build her up into the image and likeness of Jesus. We look forward to seeing what you will do in and through her. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello, my name is Kelly Pack, and I am a shepherd in the Mexico Family Church. Our scripture reading today will be Acts 15, 1-35. But because this is a long passage, I am only going to be reading Acts 15, 1-11. However, Pastor Mitchell asked that you read the entire passage either by pausing the video now or after the sermon ends. So please open your Bibles to Acts 15, 1-11 for today's scripture reading. But some men came down from Judea and were teaching the brothers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved." And after Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas and some of the others were appointed to go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and the elders about this question. So, being sent on their way by the church, they passed through both Phoenicia and Samaria, describing in detail the conversion of the Gentiles, and brought great joy to all the brothers. When they came to Jerusalem, they were welcomed by the church and the apostles and the elders, and they declared all that God had done with them. But some believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees rose up and said, "It is necessary to circumcise them and to order them to keep the law of Moses." The apostles and the elders were gathered together to consider this matter, and after there had been much debate, Peter stood up and said to them, "Brothers, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you, that by my mouth the Gentiles should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, who knows the heart, bore witness to them, by giving them the Holy Spirit just as he did to us. And he made no distinction between us and them, having cleansed their hearts by faith. Now, therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing a yoke on the neck of the disciples that neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear? But we believe that we will be saved through the grace of our Lord Jesus, just as they will." This is God's word for us today. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your saving grace and the blessing of the cross. Would you incline our ears and our hearts to hear you as you speak through Pastor Mitchell? We often go astray in our own thoughts and our perspectives, but your love never ceases. You continue to shower us with your grace. May the gospel ring true and loudest in our hearts and our minds, and may you lead us back to your cross daily. Amen.
Well, good afternoon, the home church, and thank you, Kelly, for praying just right now. Feels good to be preaching after a two-week break, and we are back in the book of Acts. And the book of Acts is 28 chapters long, and today we start chapter 15. We're going to cover the bulk of this chapter. And starting chapter 15 means that we officially begin the second half of the book of Acts today. And so what I wanted to do real quick is to do a brief, just fly-by summary of Acts chapters 1 through 14 so that we could regather our sense of context and what's been happening in the story of the early church. And so I want to start in Acts chapter 1, Acts chapter 1 verse 8, where Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, stands there before his 11 disciples. And he says that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And so he outlines this mission in an order too, in Jerusalem where they currently are located, into Judea, the broader region, Samaria, you know, a different region that they wouldn't have wanted to go to as fully ethnic Jews, and then to the ends of the earth, i.e. the Gentiles, okay? And then Jesus ascends to heaven. And then in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit descends from heaven to empower these apostles. And God displays his heart for the nations on the day of Pentecost. And he displays his heart for the nations because the 120 Christians that were gathered waiting for the Holy Spirit in prayer, and they were in unity, they started to speak in different human languages. This was this multilingual miracle that displayed God's global heart for all. And you guys know what happens. Peter the apostle stands up, preaches a bold presentation of the gospel. Thousands of people place their faith in Christ, repent of their sins, get baptized, and the church is born right there in the city of Jerusalem, the same city that crucified Jesus just 50 days prior. Okay, amazing. The community is thriving. They're sacrificing for each other. There's great joy. God is adding daily to the church as they are just this new community that the world has never seen before. And then in Acts chapter 4 through 8, we see some persecution begin to mount against the Jerusalem church. But the church continues to grow. And then what begins to happen around Acts chapter 6 is some Hellenists join the church. Remember, the Hellenists are Greek culture Jews. So now we've got some multicultural stuff taking place in the previously 100% ethnically Jewish church. Soon after that, we have the gospel going into Samaria through Philip, right? And so now that second part of Acts chapter 1 verse 8, being witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, the bigger region, and then now Samaria, the third part, that's taking place. And remember, the Samaritans are half Jewish, half Gentile, and they begin to join the early church movement, and churches get planted throughout Samaria. And then Acts chapter 10 comes around, and something amazing happens. The Holy Spirit connects the Apostle Peter, fully Jewish, and this high-ranking Roman official named Cornelius, fully Gentile, and they meet together, and Peter has this vision, and Cornelius and his whole household meet Peter. Peter shares the gospel. They receive the Holy Spirit. They are showing clear evidence that the same Holy Spirit that gifted and empowered the Jewish believers is now doing the same with the Gentile believers. But even with Cornelius, though he was fully 100% ethnically Gentile, and this was a big moment in the early church, he was a proselyte. And a proselyte was a Gentile who fully embraced Jewish tradition and culture, right? And so they began to join the church. But then Acts chapter 11 happens. The church in Antioch is born, okay? 400 miles north of Jerusalem, right? And the Apostle Paul, 100% Jewish, and Barnabas, who's Hellenist, They plant this church, they lead this church, they establish a church that is predominantly Gentile, okay? So we have this trend that's taking place. And that, where we started with a pure 100% ethnically Jewish starting point, and we're gradually becoming more Gentile, okay? And then in Acts chapters 13 and 14, this is where we last were, that church in Antioch, predominantly Gentile church led by Paul and Barnabas, they commission Paul and Barnabas to a mission trip, the first officially commissioned mission trip. And they had a mission trip to take the gospel to the Gentiles, to plant churches, raise up leaders, so the gospel movement can continue, the early church movement can continue. And then we start to see that last part of Acts chapter 1, verse 8, where the gospel is going to the ends of the earth, to Gentiles. So we have Gentiles joining the church. So you have to understand, this is a big, monumental moment in the development of the Christian movement. Because understand, you got to understand from the Jewish perspective, for the past 2,000 years, God has worked primarily and almost exclusively through the line of Abraham and through Abraham's grandson, okay, which would have been Jacob or Israel. And Israel had 12 sons. Those are the 12 tribes of Israel. It's to these people, to this line, to this ethnicity and culture, that the Old Testament scriptures and the covenants and the miracles and the prophets and the law and the temple and circumcision, the symbol of the Abrahamic covenant, all of these things were given to Israel from the true and living God. Remember also that Jesus was 100% ethnically Jewish. All 12 of his apostles, 100% Jewish. Jesus never did ministry outside of the borders of Israel. The first church began in Jerusalem, 100% ethnically Jewish. And so you have to understand that even though Jesus already told these apostles in many different ways and in many different places in the Gospels that they should reach the Gentiles, that he had sheep of another fold, even though he told them in the Great Commission in Galilee that they were to make disciples in all the nations, and even though in Acts chapter 1 in Jerusalem, he said, you will be witnesses to the ends of the earth, it still hasn't fully sunk in yet, okay? Because for thousands of years, God has been working primarily, almost exclusively with Jewish people and Jewish culture and Jewish tradition. But now, in this moment of the book of Acts, you've got some straight up Gentiles, previously pagan worshiping, wild Gentiles converting into the faith. And so now what will this Jewish, predominantly Jewish church do? The question becomes, do Gentiles have to become Jewish? Do they need to abide by the dietary laws of the Old Testament? Do they need to get circumcised like all the rest of the Jewish men did? Except, you know, the Jewish men did it 8 days after they were born, right? But these are fully grown Gentile men. So these are important, big questions. And so we see when this is the issue. How will the early church handle this? Are they going to divide over it? Are they going to come together in agreement? That is the issue. And so THC, what we will see today, and I hope your heart just gets a big picture of this. What we will see today is just how much of a blessing the gospel really is. And what the gospel does when properly understood and properly applied to your life and our corporate life as a church community. Because this passage really shows what makes Christianity so unique and wonderful. The title of today's message is The Blessings of the Gospel. And I'm going to outline 4 blessings of the gospel from this chapter. We're not going to get the entire chapter done today. We're going to get the vast majority. And so here's number one. Okay. 4 blessings of the gospel. Number one, the gospel is simple. This is a blessing, okay? So we're introduced to the problem, to the issue in verse 1, and then also in verse 5, which kind of restates it, where we learn that there are believers, that's important, these are Christians, these are Jewish believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees. Remember, the Pharisees were the most passionate in their confidence that they could keep the law of Moses, okay? The Apostle Paul was previously a Pharisee. So there were some Christians, some believers, who were from the Pharisee sect of Judaism. They rise up at the news of all these Gentiles, right, getting saved. And then they say, it is necessary to circumcise them and to order them to keep the law of Moses. This is the big issue. These people believed in Jesus. They trusted in Jesus for salvation. Jesus was their Lord. They believed he was the Messiah. They believed he was the Son of God. But when it came to these Gentiles, they said, you know what? These Gentiles need to do what we've been doing for thousands of years. They need to get circumcised and they need to keep the law of Moses. Okay? And this is why, number one, the gospel is a blessing, because it is so simple. Okay? I think what would be helpful is if we gave a definition of what is the gospel at this point. You know, what is the gospel? The gospel, I'm going to share it this way with you. The gospel is this, is the idea that salvation, or being rescued from sin, salvation comes about by one's faith in Jesus plus nothing else. That's the gospel. That is the good news. Okay? And it's simple. Like, when you see it that way, it is simple. Now let's talk a little bit about what we're talking about when we say faith in Jesus, okay? Is it simply believing that Jesus existed historically? No. Is it simply believing that Jesus was the Son of God? No. Is it simply believing that Jesus died on the cross for sin? No. Belief in Jesus is beyond all of these things. Let me give it to you this way. You'll see it on the screen. Salvation, or being rescued from sin, is trusting or resting in Jesus's work on the cross alone and not my own works. Man, this is so important. It all comes down to your view of Jesus and what he did on the cross. See, to believe in Jesus, or to trust in Jesus, or to place your faith in Jesus, all these phrases are really communicating the same thing. It means that you believe Jesus' words from the cross when he declared and cried out, "It is finished." What was finished? Meaning that there is nothing left for you to do to earn salvation except believe that Jesus earned our salvation through his sinless life and sacrificial death and resurrection. See, to trust in Jesus's perfection, in Jesus's holiness and goodness, is to recognize the utter bankruptcy of your own goodness and holiness and perfection. See, why am I going to heaven and not hell? Okay, Mitchell is going to heaven and not hell. Why? Because I don't sin as much as others? Nope. Because I tithe to the home church? Nope. Because I read the Bible and pray? Nope. Because I believe that God exists? Nope. Because I'm a good person? Definitely nope. Okay. Listen, the reason I'm going to heaven, the reason I'm made right with God, the reason I am not going to hell, has nothing to do with me or my good works or my good heart, which isn't good at all. It has everything to do with Jesus's goodness, with his perfection, with his holiness. Let me give you an analogy. Like, if I went to the beach and I wanted to go swimming, but when I got to the beach, I saw a bunch of signs over and over that said the same thing. Don't swim. There are dangerous riptides in this area. But then I decide to ignore all the signs, and I rebelliously go out there, and I begin to, guess what, get pulled in by a riptide, okay? All because I wanted to swim. And I'm trying my hardest with all my might to get back to the shore, but the waves are pulling me deeper and deeper, farther and farther into the ocean. I'm being pulled into the depths of the ocean. I am drowning. My strength is depleting. It's not looking good for me. But then a lifeguard, way stronger than me, okay? Like the body that's ripped like Daniel Lee, okay? He swims out to me. And when he gets to me, I have zero energy left. He tells me to hold on to his shoulders. I try, but I can't. I'm not even strong enough to hold on to him. And so he says, "That's okay, I'll hold on to you." And he puts me on his shoulders and takes me back to the shore. And there I am, laying on the sand, exasperated, exhausted, okay? And suddenly, a news van pulls up right next to me. A reporter jumps out, sticks a microphone in my face, and says, "Sir, that was amazing. We caught the whole ordeal on camera. How did you save yourself from those vicious riptides?" I would be the most arrogant and prideful fool to take any credit. Right? I mean, that's the honest answer. The right answer would be something along the lines of, "Listen, I was a fool. I was a rebel. I was a lawbreaker, but that lifeguard over there rescued me. And it was all him and nothing to do with me. He swam to me. And all I did was trust in his ability to save me. Trust in his ability to hold me. It was all him." Listen, THC, there was and there is simply no way that you or I could save ourselves from our sin. Ephesians chapter 2 verses 8 and 9 puts it this way: "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." So what is the gospel? This is extremely important. The gospel is not the idea that we are saved, that we have salvation by our faith in Jesus plus some good works. See, that's not the gospel. And that's the whole issue that's taking place here in Acts chapter 15. There was Paul and Barnabas that passionately said, "It's just gospel plus, it's just faith in Jesus plus nothing else." But there were these Judaizers, these Jewish believers that said, "No, it's faith in Jesus plus circumcision, plus law keeping that results in salvation." And Paul and Barnabas and Peter and James and many more of the apostles and the elders at the Jerusalem church, they saw this as an issue worth fighting over, and it was. But listen, the gospel is a blessing because it's so simple. There's no 100-mile hike in the desert that you have to go through in order to receive salvation. Like, the gospel is not complicated, actually. Like, what a blessing that God not only saves us, but makes salvation so simple. In an instant, when any heart truly humbles themselves and puts genuine, sincere faith in Jesus to save them, salvation takes place just like that. Regeneration takes place just like that. Justification takes place just like that. Instantly. Amazing. Simple. The gospel is simple, but man, it is hard to continually rest in it. It's hard for many to trust in something so simple. In fact, there have been many times where I've heard from the lips of VIPs or from non-Christians, like "I can't get right with God until I clean up my life first." Or I've heard it this way, which is, "I can't get baptized until I stop sinning as much as I do." But listen, that's the whole point of the gospel, is that you can't do enough good works. It's that simple. It's a blessing. And it's not just VIPs that struggle with the simplicity of the gospel. It's believers, you and me, that struggle with the simplicity of the gospel. We struggle to believe that it actually is that simple, right? Verse 5, which is important, says that it's believers who are saying that works must be added to faith in order for them to be truly saved. So understand, we all need to be reminded of the gospel, whether you're a Christian or a non-Christian. As one author says, we never graduate from the gospel. So that's the first point, the first blessing of the gospel. It's simple, right? Number two, second blessing, the gospel removes the burden of performance. So what happens in this debate, they're going back and forth trying to sort this out. There's passionate perspectives on one side, there's passionate perspectives on the other. And Peter, he stands up. This is actually going to be the last words of Peter in the book of Acts. He disappears after this from the narrative. Luke really hones in on the story of Paul from here on out. But Peter, he stands up and he gives this amazing speech once again. This anointed thing, I want to pick up in verse 10 and 11. He says, why are you, he's talking to the Judaizers, why are you putting God to the test by placing a yoke on the neck of the disciples that neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear? But we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus, just as they will. Peter says, that the Judaizers are placing a yoke on these Gentile disciples. What's a yoke? A yoke was this heavy beam that was placed on a cattle. It represents heaviness. It represents work, labor, exhaustion. I'm gonna show you a photo of a yoke right there. And it's interesting because Peter has to remind them about their own nation's history of failure to the law, and also their own absolute inability to actually live according to the law of Moses themselves. See, the great error of the Jews was they thought that they could please God. They thought that they could enter into heaven, that they could enter into the kingdom of God through their own performance, through their own adherence and obedience to the law, but they couldn't. And it's not just the error of the Jews back then. It's the same error that people make today, believers and non-believers. See, a lot of people think that the purpose of the Ten Commandments is that it's supposed to be some type of map to salvation. That if one obeys these Ten Commands, these Ten Laws, God is pleased and you're saved, right? But the Ten Commandments, the laws of God, are not a map. They are a mirror, okay? And guess what? No one can faithfully obey the Ten Commandments. That's actually the point of the Ten Commandments and all of the laws, is to point out that you can't obey them. And then lots of people, they say, well, you know what? That's just the Old Testament. But Jesus came and he did away with the Old Testament. And Jesus essentially said that as long as you love God and love your neighbor, do good to those around you, then you're good. But friends, that's not what Jesus said. That's not what he said. In fact, in Matthew chapter 22, picking up in verse 35, a lawyer, a Pharisee actually, asks Jesus a question to test him. He says, teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? Now keep in mind, there are about 613 Old Testament laws that Jesus could have chose from. And this person that's asking, this lawyer, isn't coming with a sincere question. He's coming to test, to trap Jesus, to pin him. And he probably has some rebuttals prepared. If Jesus, you know, says a certain type of law, emphasizes one and doesn't the other. But Jesus responds by quoting from Deuteronomy chapter 6. He says, you shall love the Lord your God, notice, with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. Listen, I don't know how you feel when you heard the words all right there, but they're not designed to make you feel good. They're not designed to make you feel able to obey these commands of Jesus, okay? If Jesus said something like, the most important law was to love the Lord your God with some of your heart and some of your soul and some of your mind, then maybe many of us could feel good about our ability to fulfill, to live, obey that law. But notice, he doesn't say some, he doesn't say most, he says all of your heart, soul, and strength. Can any one of us really honestly say that we've loved God with all of us? No way. Every time, in fact, that we disobey God, we are essentially saying to God, we love ourselves and the sin and the disobedience more than you and your laws and your ways. That's really what sin is, right? And what Jesus is trying to do in this passage is show us that we fall short of God's commands and standards and law. Jesus is trying to show them, and he's trying to show us by application, that we can't obey God fully. The law is a mirror. And what does a mirror do? It simply reflects to you your true condition. So let's say you roll out of bed tomorrow, Monday morning, getting ready for school or getting ready for work. I mean, unless you're like doing school and work from home, this analogy breaks. But pretend with me, okay? Back to the old days, the pre-quarantine days. You roll out of bed tomorrow and you head on over where? First place you go when you wake up. You go to the bathroom, right? And what happens when you go to the bathroom? You end up looking into a mirror at some point. And what do you see? You see a bunch of eye crust around the eyes. You see some cobwebs in the nostrils. You see some dried up drool on the side of your lips. The mirror helps you see that you're messed up. And so what do? After you see the mess, do you punch the mirror? You don't punch the mirror. Do you take the mirror off your wall and then you try to take out the boogers and the dried up drool and the cobwebs? You pull the mirror off the wall and try to like pick off all that junk from your face? No, you don't. See, the mirror isn't meant to remove the mess. It just shows you that you're a mess, okay? And this is why the gospel is a blessing. Because once you come to that point when you realize that you are not good, that you're actually bad, because the law reveals that you fall short of God's standards, when you realize that you're prideful and that you're broken, that you need someone to save you from yourself and from sin and from selfishness, that's when you realize that Jesus has come to remove the burden of the law, because he and only he can faithfully live under the commands of God. See, Jesus didn't come to remove the law. He came to fulfill the law. But the law can't save us because we constantly break the law. But this is why the gospel is a blessing, because it removes that burden of performance, where all of that weight is on you to perform, for you to do good works and spiritual activities. Man, our whole life is based on performance. It's been deeply downloaded into us from childhood. Like even right now, the way that we're training baby Judah, we'll tell him like, you want milk from mama? And we teach him baby sign language. That's the sign of more. Milk is this, okay? And so oftentimes we'll say, okay, Judah, if you do this, we're gonna reward that performance with some milk. And then my two older kids, Isabel and Isaiah, we tell them, now kids, if you finish your homework, you can go on your iPads, right? Your performance will be rewarded. But if you don't do the performance, you won't get rewarded. And then later on, when they get into high school, I'm gonna tell them, study hard for your classes, for your tests, your finals, your SATs. Actually, maybe not the SATs. I'm sure you heard, UCs might not be requiring that anymore. So who knows what will happen by the time Belle and Zay are in high school. But that whole idea of studying hard academically, and take the most advanced classes that you can so that you could get into the best college that you can. Rewards by performance. You get into good schools based on performance. You get good jobs based on performance. You get pay raises based on performance. And when you get married, you sometimes get some loving based on performance, okay? Different story, okay, new tap, let's start over. But when it comes to your standing with God, okay, God's not going to accept you based on your performance or good works. Because if he did, we all fail. What God is asking is that you trust in the performance of Jesus and him alone, not yourself, so that you cannot boast. It's grace. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful that God doesn't say, if you obey, then I will accept you? No, God says, I accept you based on the performance of Jesus. And our obedience flows from our acceptance, not the other way around. And so VIPs and Christians, listen, in many things in life, performance is important. I'm not saying that we shouldn't be putting great effort into our academic life and into our careers, but when it comes to your spiritual state, you have to understand that you are woefully unable to meet the performance requirements. You are a tricycle that's missing a wheel at a NASCAR race trying to get first place. Like, you're not even a tricycle anymore. What are you? A bike, I guess. You're gonna lose, and you're probably gonna die losing in that race. And I think Peter says it so well here in his argument. He's saying essentially trying to get to God based on your ability to obey his commands is a burden that none of us can lift. Friend, rest in Jesus's work. He did say from the cross, it is finished. There is nothing left for you or I to add to what Jesus said. Jesus didn't say from the cross, it's almost done. If only my followers do X, Y, Z. He said, it is finished. Rest in that. Rest in that. That's where peace and joy can come, when you understand that Jesus paid it all. Nothing left. The gospel removes the burden of performance. Number three, the gospel humbles our pride. This is a blessing, okay? Verse 12, you know, after Peter gives this whole little speech about the gospel of grace, he basically preaches the gospel to them, okay? And he reminds all people present what grace really is. Undeserved, unmerited favor and blessing. And we read this in verse 12, that all the assembly fell silent. Isn't that beautiful? And they ended up listening to Paul and Barnabas and all that God had done on that first missionary journey in Acts 14 and 15 when they went to all those Gentile cities. See, when Peter said those words of the gospel and reminded them of the grace that they've been given, the people became silent. They were reminded of grace, of truth. They were thinking, oh yeah, Peter's right. How could we have forgotten? We couldn't live according to the law. That's why it's grace. That's why Jesus died. And this is so important. What caused this group of very passionately opinionated believers to get into the proper posture of humility and actually listen to one another in a way that ends up resulting in a unified decision for the entire early church was what? It was the gospel itself. It was that reminder that they were saved by grace, not by effort or good work. Listen, you can't boast or brag when you're saved by grace. If you're saved by your own effort, you can't boast. And this is important for the development of our character, which the Holy Spirit wants to make our character like Jesus's character, okay? That's one of the things the Holy Spirit wants to do. What this is telling us is that we don't just need the gospel to cleanse us from sin. We actually need the gospel for our character to be developed. Okay? Like we come to know God by faith in the gospel. That's salvation. But we also come to grow in God by faith in the gospel as well. That's called sanctification. You know, in our foundation class, which if you haven't taken it, I hope that you take that ASAP, okay? But in that foundation class, one of my favorite things to teach is that true spiritual growth is not just knowledge increase. And it's also not just the accruement of years being a Christian. Like, you don't spiritually grow simply by coming to church longer, by reading more of the Bible, by knowing more theology, by extending your prayer time, right? By learning worship songs, by raising your hands in worship songs. You get the point. Spiritual growth is actually determined by how much of your pride, how much of that pride that you have is broken, and how yielded, how controlled you are by the Holy Spirit. Some of the most knowledgeable Christians are the most spiritually immature. Trust me, guys, like knowing the Bible, knowing theological concepts, without heart transformation, without humility, without Christ-like character, like the fruit of the Spirit that Chad talked about last week, that's actually dangerous. You could be self-deceived and equate knowing more with spiritual growth. But if it's not touching your character, is it spiritual growth? It's not. But when you realize just how broken and how wicked and how sinful you are, and when you realize that you are saved by grace, like, how can you ever brag? How can you have a posture of just wanting to just get your point across in this big conflict that we had here? No, when you're reminded of grace and when you're properly understanding grace, you're just left there in that position of silence and awe before God because you know that you were undeserving of that grace. So on Wednesday this past week, we had Psalm 101 as our reading for that day. And Psalm 101 was written by David, and Bible scholars believe that David wrote Psalm 101 at the time that he was finally able to become the king of Israel. And if you're unfamiliar, David had to wait quite a while before he actually got the reins of the kingdom. He had to like run away and go into hiding from King Saul, who was trying to hunt him down and kill him. But the title of this chapter, David didn't name this title, but Bible editors like, you know, titled this chapter, "I Will Walk with Integrity." And I was just teaching this to our family church this past week, that David really wrote this psalm as a declaration of commitment of how he would rule as king. And what we see here in this declaration is a whole lot of confidence in his own ability to be a good, faithful, God-honoring, holy king, okay? And he has these very confident statements. Let me just show you two of them from Psalm 101. The first, he says, "I will walk with integrity of heart within my house." He says, "A perverse heart shall be far from me. I will know nothing of evil." But for those of us who are familiar with what happens later in David's life, we know that he is not going to be able to live up to his own profession of commitment here, right? One day, David's going to see a naked woman who already has a husband, and he's going to desire her, and he's going to use his kingly authority and power to arrange to have sex with her. That's adultery, by the way, okay? And then he's going to conveniently arrange for her husband to be on the front lines of the next military battle, ensuring his death. And that's called murder, okay? That hardly looks like a man who says, "I will know nothing of evil. I will walk with integrity of heart." See, when we read a psalm like that, we have to read it with the awareness that David hoped to be someone he could never be. Only Jesus truly walked with integrity of heart. Only Jesus knew nothing of evil. See, the gospel, when properly understood, humbles us to our proper place, to the realization that all are equal at the foot of the cross. We are all undeserving sinners that have been saved by grace. And that leads to the fourth and final blessing of the gospel that I want to talk about with you today, and that is the gospel creates a gracious church. A little tongue twister there. This issue could have easily led to a division that caused the Jerusalem and Antioch church to split in ugly fashion, and the devil would have smiled from ear to ear if this, you know, took place. But the leaders, they fought through it, okay? They fought through the disagreements with a commitment to stay together. The leaders met together. Paul and Barnabas go all the way down to Jerusalem to hammer this out. And they're arguing passionately, yes, but it was the gospel of grace by faith that became the common ground. And Paul and Barnabas and Peter speak, and James as well, and they're representing the side that says, you know what? Let the Gentiles come as they are. No snip-snip on the privates, right? And then the Judaizers, these are those Pharisee Christians representing that side that says they need to do what we had to do, and they need to do the Jewish stuff in order to remain saved and part of the covenant family of Israel. See, the understanding of the gospel itself was not just the issue they were fighting over, but it also became the solution for their fight to be over. See, listen, at THC, I want you guys to understand this. There will always be, and there currently is, and there always will be, some of us in our church that really stress God's grace and the liberties of the Christian faith and making things as easy as possible for VIPs. But there is now and always will be those who more stress the necessity of obedience and fruits of repentance, like visible fruit, and also just strong urgings to stay away from worldliness to our new believers. See, Paul, Barnabas, Peter, and James, they chose not to divide over this, but to remain together. THC, the mark of understanding God's grace on your life is your ability to show grace to one another. And this grace is seen in other ways too. Perhaps my favorite part about this chapter is the beautiful outcome of this meeting, in that both the Gentile believers and the Jewish believers make compromises for the sake of the other side. The Jewish believers agree that they should not force the Gentile believers to get circumcised and fully embrace the Jewish rituals and customs. And then the Gentile believers agreed to the following in verse 20. This comes from James. And by the way, this James is not the same James who was the apostle. That James passed away a few chapters ago. Believe it or not, this is James, the brother of Jesus, who wrote the book of James in the New Testament. And he just appears magically kind of in this story. But I want you to know also the whole vision that Peter had with the large sheet. And when he met Cornelius, that happened 10 years prior to this incident. So the book of Acts is chronicling this kind of fast, but really some time has passed. And in this time gap, James, the half-brother of Jesus, becomes a follower of Jesus and a leader in the church. And when you read the text closely, it appears that he is kind of the moderator, the chairman, like that has even greater authority than Peter, it seems, in this whole ordeal, which is interesting. But James comes up with this compromise, where he says, we're not going to have the Gentiles get circumcised. They don't have to fully obey the Jewish ritual laws. But here's what we do ask, that they abstain from the things polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, and from what has been strangled, and from blood. Essentially, this was the Jewish believers asking for the Gentile believers to choose to abstain from certain things that were normal to the Gentile pagan culture that they would have grown up in and been accustomed to. Because, you know, so the Jewish believers, the Jewish leaders are asking these Gentile believers to abstain from these things because it could offend the Jewish believers and their culture. So for example, in the Gentile pagan world back then, it was very common for meat to be cooked as a worship ritual, like in front of a pagan statue. So from the Gentile Christians, it was not a big deal. It's like, this is just meat, you know, meat is meat. But it was a big deal to the Jewish Christians who were taught over and over for thousands of years, you shall not have any graven image, right? Worship God and Him alone. Certain meats would, they would be cooked, but sometimes they would still be dripping with blood. I mean, we call that like rare. I love rare meat. You know, there's still a little bit of blood in there, right? And for the Gentiles, from their perspective, you know, it wasn't a big deal to eat some rare meat, but it was a big deal to the Jewish Christians, right? And then also the sexual immorality part of that, that's not likely talking about, you know, like sex outside of marriage or having multiple partners or even homosexuality. What likely that is talking about is that in the Gentile world, to marry within your own family was not really considered that big of a deal. But from a Jewish perspective, to marry within your own close relatives, that was a big deal to the Jewish Christians. So understand, this is very important for you to understand. These four things that are listed out, these are not commands, rules that these Gentile believers must obey to remain Christian. No. I mean, that would undermine the entire chapter. That would undermine all of Paul, Barnabas, and Peter's words. This is a compromise where both parties are surrendering preferences for the sake of the other in the spirit of love. See, the Gentile conscience was clean, but if their liberties violated, stumbled, offended the consciences of a significant portion of the church, their own spiritual brothers and sisters, or if it could get in the way of Jewish non-believers receiving Christ, the Jerusalem church said, yeah, can you guys just do that like Queen Elsa thing from Frozen and just let it go, okay? Just let those things go. And we know that this is the case. This is the reasoning that James gives in verse 21. James says that they should abide by these four rules. He says, because from ancient generations, Moses' law has had in every city those who proclaim him, for he is read every Sabbath in the synagogues. So they're saying, you know, they still want to win VIP Jews. And if these Gentile Christians, who are now witnesses of Christ, advancing the gospel themselves, their own actions might unnecessarily offend and push people away from the gospel of grace. So that's the whole thing that's going on here. So the Jerusalem church, the leaders there, and also Paul and Barnabas, who are technically aren't leaders of the Jerusalem church, but in Antioch, everyone, all of the leaders are asking the rest of the church to compromise a little bit for the sake of unity and for the sake of reaching Gentile and Jewish VIPs. To the Jews, you know, getting circumcised, they're like, that's not a big deal. But to the Gentiles, they're like, hey now, this is a big deal. Ain't no snip snip going down if we don't have to, okay? But what's amazing, and we're gonna see this next week, slight little teaser. What's amazing is Paul, who in this section is so passionate to really say that Gentiles must not be forced to get circumcised to appease some incorrect understanding of the gospel. That same Paul, next chapter, is gonna circumcise young adult Timothy, full-grown man. And by the way, Timothy allows it, okay? Why? Because Timothy was Greek, he never got circumcised, and they were about to do missions in a Jewish context. And Timothy's Gentile wee-wee, okay, could theoretically, possibly get in the way of seeing Jews embrace the gospel. So Paul says, let's chop off that skin for love, for evangelism, for evangelistic effectiveness, okay? Talk about making sacrifices for VIPs, man. Timothy, when we see you in heaven, you're gonna get one of these from all the dudes. We're just like, bruh, mad respect. But THC, when we properly understand the good news, the gospel as a church community, you know what one of the natural effects of that is? is we are going to sacrifice our own rights and preferences for the sake of loving one another, and also for the sake of presenting a more beautiful witness of the gospel to non-believers. Man, I wonder, you know, what is it in your life that you need to surrender in order for the gospel to work more powerfully in your family church? What is it in your life that you need to surrender so that the gospel could work more powerfully amongst the VIPs you're trying to invite in your life? Something to ponder, definitely. And in closing, I love how verses 30 through 35 end with these Gentile believers. This letter has been drafted, and Paul and Barnabas and a few others, they go back to the church of Antioch and they read this letter to resolve this issue. And it says in verse 31 that when they, the church of Antioch, predominantly Gentiles, when they had read it, they rejoiced because of its encouragement. Even though they had to make sacrifices, they still rejoiced and they were encouraged by the whole entire thing. THC, the gospel is a blessing, isn't it? It saves us, it grows us, it unites us, it frees us from the burden of performance, it humbles us to the right posture, and it motivates us to lay down our preferences for the sake of loving others. And it becomes the foundation for a beautiful church community that reflects the character of Christ. And so may we just rest in the gospel. May we just take joy in that blessing. May we worship right now with joy. And I'm praying that this blessing of the gospel just pushes us to bless God more in worship, to bless others, and to bless VIPs. Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the gospel. It is truly good news to bad hearts, to broken hearts, to burdened hearts. Jesus, how could we ever repay? We owe you everything for the salvation that you gave us. Holy Spirit, come. Open our eyes to see the beauty of the gospel. Open our eyes to see the burdens lifted. Humble our hearts, break down our pride, remind us of grace, and may our family churches and THC as a whole display grace, love, sacrifice, and blessing to one another. In Jesus' name, amen.
And now we will be having a time of offering. If you are a guest at this church, tuning in for the first time, or if you are a seeker of Christ, please do not feel obligated to give. Here at the Home Church, we believe that the giving of our tithes and offering is the joyful responsibility of our covenanted church members. And you may give either on our Home Church app, or you may give at thehomechurchroland.com at the Giving tab. Thank you.
This song might also be a new song. It's called The Blessing by Carrie Jove and Cody Carnes. Sing, the Lord bless you. You peace.
last song we're going to sing is called Indescribable. And I want us to start with the second chorus and especially focus on the part that says, incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. And I think that's just a very simple way to sing the gospel. Let's worship together.
Uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God.
Incomparable.
Incomparable and unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart.
Amen.
Well, THC, as we close out this week's service, and before doing the benediction, I actually want to read from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 through 25. The author of Hebrews says, "And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." Man, I want to encourage you after the benediction to remain on this this stream and share, type away in the chat, any takeaways from today's service as a way to spur one another on toward love and good deeds, as a way of encouraging one another as a church community. And so please stick around and be part of that so we could be united in this as a church. And at this time, let's close with the benediction, and I'll see you in the chat. Now, THC, return to the world with a peaceful heart. Be courageous in doing good, and do not return evil for evil. Always help the weak, visit the sick, comfort suffering neighbors. Respect everyone, serve the Lord and love Him. Do all things in faith and love. Never give up hope, no matter what the circumstance. And live a life of joy and thanksgiving as you obey the Holy Spirit. Our Father God will always help you. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said, Amen.
Come, that you're from, and come, is a hallelujah. In the presence of my enemies, I raise a hallelujah.